very soon after 1990 already, the aim was achieved, an independent Namibia. So the paper very quickly had to become an independent newspaper. And being a Republican is also someone who puts his country first, or her country. I started working at Republikein in the year 2002, originally as a proofreader, I would say, looking at language. Quickly became a journalist and then went through the ranks, reporter, senior reporter, news editor, and finally I had the privilege to be the editor of the Afrikaans Daily in Namibia. It was a tough job to take on. Of course, we had very big editors, well-known journalists at the Republikein, before I was preceded by the likes of the Desi Rasmus and Chris Jacobis and Estelle de Brains of the world. So yes, it was a tough job. It was a tough job in an already changing media landscape, but I thoroughly enjoyed it as well, to take on that challenge. Republikein has always had a culture of sharing the stories of Namibia. That is why the paper was born, and also to make a positive impact on our country, to change things for the better. And that is also something that from the word go I found amongst the staff. But I mean, like in any workplace, obviously, people in the media are also competitive, and that helps to bring the best out of each one. And the Republikein slogan was "Jou land, jou taal, jou courant," and then we changed it to "Jou nuus," because it's a long time now that we're not only in print, but on all platforms, social platforms, on the internet, on the television as well. But using the word "you," saying it's yours, allows people to take ownership, and it's also your language. Afrikaans is taal wat baie van ons kan praat en verstaan. Dit is ook uniek aan Suider-Afrika. Ons vier ook dit en histories in ons land natuurlik. Republikein is a historical fact. It used to be a political mouthpiece of the Republican Party, which was part of the Democratic Tuanala Alliance, today's PDM. But very soon after 1990 already, the aim was achieved, an independent Namibia. So the paper very quickly had to become an independent newspaper, which was within a couple of years, by 1998 at the latest. I mean, we were completely already there. And being a Republican is also someone who puts his country first, or her country. So that term definitely strikes a lot wider than a specific political party and its ideals of way back when. For a Republican, the Constitution is also of paramount importance, and that is something we as media and as individuals in our country, as organizations, should enforce every single day and respect the rights of others, and also make sure that we keep people accountable. People management, I think, is always difficult, but it's also rewarding to work with people. Changing, the media has been changing such a lot, like most of life, most of working life, and that the change hasn't stopped with artificial intelligence already making inroads into many jobs. So the thing with change is you have to embrace it, and also give people the opportunity to learn new skills. And very important is to empower them beforehand. that takes away a lot of the resistance. Klits Kompas, and I must say I'm not the pioneer, it was an idea proposed by Albie Botha, the CEO, and a lot of us worked together. It's something we had to do that was completely new. We went on Facebook in 2019, that is 5 years ago, and later on it became a TV program as well. And it's with change. We had to learn doing things step by little small step, and we were petrified, we were afraid, and today is something we do every day and we love. Stories are told a lot quicker today than ever before, than 22 years ago when I started in the profession. But soon after that already we had the internet, social media came along. Video ever more important in reporting news events. So that meant that journalists had to become multi-skilled, and that process hasn't finished. Media must work harder to make sure their voice is heard, and that they have a unique voice and that they can be trusted. I think telling our own stories is something that Namibia is maybe not that good at. We must be much better. Also media institutions, archiving is often wanting in Namibia. The Republikein is coming up on 50 years, and that's definitely going to be a big celebration. And the story is also about what we can learn from the past, because no matter how things change, the solid basics of good journalism lies way back in history. Afrikaans is alive and well in Namibia. It's a vibrant language. Many people speak it. I think as in South Africa and elsewhere in the world, people might be worried about pressure on the formal functions of Afrikaans. And we have to sometimes adapt the way we use the language based on who do we want to reach with what specific message. But Afrikaans is also a language that we must celebrate because of its beauty. I have a lot less stress since I'm not editor anymore, but I continue liking in working in the media with face and voice, not the pen, but that's one of the new skills that I learned along the way.
Ek het 30 jaar terug by Republikein begin toe dit nog in Schiebelstraat was en die drukkery alles by mekaar was. Dit was in, dis lang terug, Oktober 1993, en ek het as 'n junior verslaggewer begin. Dit was nog die dae van floppy disks, daar was nie selfone nie. Jy het die koerant uitgelê met 'n papier en 'n liniaal en 'n rooi pen. Ja, dit was baie goeie dae. Dit was 'n groot sprong van, want ek is 'n gedrukte media, en dit was nog al 'n verandering wat jy in jou kop moet maak, ek persoonlik, om nie net agter die rekenaar, want dis waar ek veilig voel, om nou uit te gaan en voor 'n kamera te beweeg, maar dis ook geweldig opwindend en al hierdie nuwe goed wat jy leer, en veral by jong mense, want daar's 'n ander energie. So ja, dit is vir my baie lekker. Ek dink definitief doen hulle, maar waar my generasie fisiese boek of 'n tydskrif in hulle hand wil vashou, is die jonger generasie lees, maar hulle lees op Instagram of Facebook, alhoewel Facebook het ek gehoor is vir my generasie, of TikTok. So ja, definitief, en die jonger generasie is baie leergierig. Hulle wil weet wat aangaan in die wêreld. Is nou so oop, jy kan inligting oral kry. So ja, ek dink die dankie Vader vir die jonger generasie wat ook daai nie sin en drijfkrag het om meer te weet van die wêreld. Definitief, ja. Ek weet nou nie of ek hier geheime mag verklap nie. Waar ons sit is alles oop. So met ander woorde, die televisiepersoneel, NTV is by mekaar, die designers is by mekaar, die journaliste is by mekaar en dit is besig, dit is vir my lekker, want jy het kans om met iemand, een designer te gaan praat oor hoe om iets te design, maar dan hoor jy weer, hoe kan jy een video maak, so dit is nogal een kookpot vir alles die teen 4 uur, 5 uur by deadline raak. Interessant, ek dink baie keer as iemand van buite af moet inkom, gaan hulle bietjie skrik vir die taalgebruik en hoe reguit ons met mekaar praat, maar dit is die een ding van media is, dit is een groep mense en ek dink dit is 'n spesiale persoon wat deel is van media en ons is 'n awesome groep. Dit is baie lekker. Dit is vir my ongelooflik spesiaal. Ek het die voorreg gehad om met mense saam te werk soos Dr. Jan Spies wat een van die stigters was van Republikein, Des Erasmus. So daar's vir my persoonlike sentiment ook daaraan want dit is groot geeste. En dis 'n ongelooflike voorreg om dit daai nalatenskap van hulle verder te vat en ek weet daar's 'n jong generasie nou wat presies dieselfde gaan doen. Is dit dieselfde taal gebruik as wat Dok Jan gepraat het, alhoewel hy was iemand wat altyd gesê het jy skryf soos iemand praat. Is dit dieselfde as vandag se generasie? Nee, dit is nie. Maar Afrikaans leef en Afrikaans leef solank ons dit praat en solank ek vir mense 'n produk kan gee wat in Afrikaans leef. Daar is so baie hoogtepunte. Die grootste is die feit dat ek die voorreg het om mense se stories te kan vertel. Baie van die stories wat ek al gedoen het, is hartseer en om gekies te word deur iemand om hulle hartseer te vertel, om hulle blydskap te vertel. Jy is soos 'n wessel. Dit is vir my 'n ongelooflike voorreg om iemand se stem te kan wees. En natuurlik die ander hoogtepunte is mense wat my lewe totaal verander het, soos Dok Jan, soos Des Erasmus, soos Ronel Rademeier. Ja, ek is baie bevoorreg. Daar's 'n reuse verskil as ek dink wat 'n naïewe, onervare, bang, sonder selfvertroue meisietjie ek eintlik was 30 jaar gelede. Dit het definitief dit wat ek oor geskryf het, die mense waarmee ek in kontak gekom het, elke storie wat jy doen, ek voel goed wat jou regtig raak, verander jou selle en dit vorm jou. So die stories wat ek gedoen het, die mense wat ek in kontak mee gebring is, ek is baie meer empatie. Die wêreld is beslis nie meer vir my net swart en wit nie. Jy het geleer daar's grys gebiede. Ek kyk met sagter oë na die wêreld. Maar ek kan ook spot as iemand vir my jok. My eerste gedagte is as iemand dink Republikein, dan moet hulle vol Republikein is aan my kant. Republikein luister. Ek dink die grootste versigtiging, as ek dit nou kan so stel, van elke liewe mens op hierdie aarde is om gehoor te kan word. En ek dink as iemand aan Republikein dink en hulle besef, ek kan iemand bel by Republikein en al kan hulle nie so steur 'n storie daaroor doen nie. Ek is gehoor. My hartseer is gehoor, my kommer is gehoor, my blydskap is gehoor. Mense wil van gehoor word en dit is wat ek wil hê met Republikein doen. Die wêreld en sy mense, elke persoon het 'n storie en 'n geskiedenis. En daar's die mooiste Afrika gesegde is wanneer iemand sterf, brand 'n biblioteek af. En ek dink dit is die grootste doel en rede vir media is om daai biblioteke lewend te hou, om neer te skryf en video's te maak en te vervilm, want oor 10, 20 jaar, ek en jy gesels nou, maar wie sê, ek is volgende jaar hier, en as ek weg is, waar is al my stories, waar is al my ervaring, so ek dink die grootste doel van media en die belangrikste doel is om te dokumenteer en om dit daai biblioteke te bewaar vir toekomstige generasies om uit te leer.
I think before I joined Republikein, when I was a teenager, you know, I wanted to be a journalist specifically for Republikein. I think mostly because my family had this reverence almost of the brand. You know, it was a more trusted brand than they would say for Al Jazeera and things like that. So it felt like the natural thing to do. If you want to be a journalist who has grown up speaking Afrikaans, it's just the natural thing to do that you'll end up at Republikein. And I think now working with Republikein, it's kind of demystified the brand for me a little bit now that I've kind of seen the strings behind the scenes. And I think I have an understanding of what Republikein actually aims to do instead of, you know, this very revered brand that it has become. And it's not this godlike entity to me anymore. It's a very practical unit, I think. I think there's scientific backing to one's mother tongue. There are studies done about learning in one's mother tongue, about you know, being loved in one's mother tongue, being appreciated in one's mother tongue. And I think Afrikaans people especially have this incredible pride in their language and in their heritage and in the kind of group that we are and the values that we tend to share. So I think it's important not only for that scientific aspect of holding up, you know, one's mother tongue and making it more accessible to people by giving them concepts and news and information in their own language that they've always spoken. But I think it just carries on that pride that Afrikaans-speaking people of, you know, all different types have. Republikein made an active decision a couple of years ago, about 2 years ago, to make sure that we are a people-centric newspaper. And while I've always considered myself a rational person and always liked systems and procedures a lot, I've really come to love speaking with people and being able to tell their story in their language and, you know, just sharing in that excitement with them. These are normal people who never expected to be in the newspaper, never expected to see their face and their stories and the things that matter to them in the newspaper. So when it does appear, there's generally this extreme excitement on their end, and I love sharing in that with them. I think just carrying on Afrikaans and the legacy that it has. I think we also have a job to demystify Afrikaans. Afrikaans over the years has gained this reputation as being a white people's language, and that is wholly untrue. So taking that away and taking that white connotation, because people of all different skin tones speak Afrikaans and it is their mother tongue and they enjoy it just as we do. So I think we have a responsibility to take that connotation away, that it is for white people only. And I think Afrikaans being such a young language, it's important for us to facilitate the growing and the development of the language. Traditional media theory, and I think the most basic of media theory, suggests to us that no medium ever truly dies out. It gets supplemented by other mediums, it is assisted by other mediums and held up by other mediums, but no medium truly dies out. You know, when TV rolled around, everybody thought radio was going to die out, and radio is still very much alive, especially in a country like Namibia, where people are far away, they don't have access to cable and signals for TV and so on. So the same with newspapers. You know, newspaper was there before even radio arrived on the scene. So it's never truly going to die out. Are we going to have to partly digitalize what we're doing and utilize the internet and social media and other forms of media like video in what we do? Absolutely. But you know, the bare basics of media theory suggests that it's not going to die out. I think the future of journalism is a lot of debunking. I think our role has shifted from, you know, bringing news and informing people of things. I think our role has now shifted to fact-checking that information and making sure that the information that people have received via other channels like social media is actually true, and whether that is a fair and balanced version of events. You know, in the past couple of years at Republikein, I've done a lot of, hey, I've seen this on social media, but what's the other side? Because as much as social media gives a voice to people, it can often give a voice to one individual person as well. So for us to seek that fairness and that balance in the media, I think is going to be a very big part of our jobs. We need to understand the youth audience a lot. Republikein, again, has this connotation that it's a middle-class, white, almost middle-aged audience. Utilizing social media has been big for us. I think being consistent on social media has helped us to understand what kinds of stories we can be telling on that medium and should be telling to the audience that follows us through that medium. I think the newspaper can also make a shift toward entertainment and make a shift toward understanding that a younger audience doesn't always have the view of the world that an older audience would have.
Ek het toe ek klaar studeer het, weet ek, ek wil in die journalistiek ingaan. In Januarie 1999 het ek by Republikein ingeval. Die laaste paar jaar en met die moontlikhede wat tegnologie geskep het, het ontwikkeling half eksponensieel geskied. En ek dink ons is deur dit alles oorweldig. Die impak wat sosiale media byvoorbeeld op mense net hulle interpersoonlike verhoudings gehad het. Die impak wat die digitale sweer op ons as journaliste gehad het, jy weet, ons het was vir die gedrukte media geskool en eensklaps moes ons net gereed wees om 24/7 in die digitale wêreld 'n teenwoordigheid te hê, jy weet. En 'n stewige voetspoor daar te kan hê. So ja, ek dink dit en dit is nou maar bloot in ons vakgebied. Maar op alle terreine dink ek van die samelewing beleef mense daai groot uitdagings. Ons het mos nie geweldige politieke onstuimighede beleef nie. En by ons wil ek amper sê het droogtes en sulke episode het amper 'n groter impak as politieke gebeure. Vloede, ons het natuurlik 'n hele paar groot vloede gehad. Ja. Ek is dankbaar dat Republikein my byvoorbeeld daai geleentheid gegee het om Suid-Afrika toe te kon gaan en saam met die res van die wêreld afskeid te neem van so 'n fenominale staatsman en geskiedkundige persoon soos Nelson Mandela. Dit was 'n ongelooflike geleentheid geweest. En weet jy, daar was ook 'n mooi storie daar nie. Ons is natuurlik nou gedruk vir tyd gewees, want ek moet my storie file vir Republikein vir die volgende dag. En wat ek nie geweet het die oggend nie, is dat daar, toe ek nou vertrek met die bus na die stadion toe in Soweto, die FNB stadion waar die geleenthede plaasgevind het, het ek nie geweet, jy weet, daar gaan 'n volledige perskamer wees en almal gaan daar sit en file nie. Christiana Amanpour van CNN, ag, die wêreld se grootste joernaliste was almal daar teenwoordig. Maar stupid ek los toe my skootrekenaar by die vriendin waar ek tuis was terwyl ek nou daar in Johannesburg was. En ek moet toe nou betyds weer by haar plek kom om gou my storie te gaan file. Maar toe die verrigting op die stadion verby is en almal moet nou stap om treine en busse en so te kry, toe is daar natuurlik 'n verskriklike toestroming van mense. En ek beland in 'n tonnel, ek moet nou onder deur 'n pad gaan, aan die ander kant uitkom en dan is daar 'n bushalte en ek kan 'n bus kry. Maar toe ek in daai tonnel kom, toe sit soos beeste in 'n drukgang en ek move nie, jy weet, daar's nie die mense staan net so saamgebondel. Daar's net eenvoudig te veel mense in te min plek om die storie aan die gang te kry. En ek voel net hoe swel hierdie paniek in my keel, want ek moet my storie gaan klaarskryf. In die volgende oomblik toe begin ek te huil, jy weet, uit regtig van paniek. Maar van die mense wat hier langs my staan, sien toe, jy weet, hier's iets fout. En hulle vra, wat is dit? En ek sê toe, I'm a journalist, I have to get to my place, I need to write my story, I need to file my story in time for my paper to go to print tonight. En hulle begin hy boodskap so vorentoe aanstuur. Make space, she's a journalist. En regtig soos die rooi see, gaan daar vir my 'n pad oop. En ek kon toe deur daai groep mense beweeg. En daarom toe nou betyds my story uiteindelik na Republikein te stuur. Ja.
Thank you.